careful not to do. Stay away from that. Wallahu alam. All right. Very quickly, I'm going to cover two more slides, and this is about oaths in Islam. An oath is a promise in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So for example, a person says, I swear by Allah that I am going to do such and such. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if one has to take an oath, then one must swear by Allah or keep quiet. So only and only make an oath by Allah or by any of his names or any of his attributes. So a person can say, I swear by the face of Allah, or by his magnificence, by his glory, by his, you know, any of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever swears by other than Allah is committing an act of kufr or shirk. Okay, so this is a very serious matter. Unfortunately, many people, based on TV dramas and movies and stuff, they learn how to take an oath from there. So what are the most dramatic oaths that people take? Mother, father, son, daughter, you know, things of this sort. None of this is allowed. So even, for example, to swear by amana. What is amana? Meaning he says, I swear by trustworthiness itself that I will not betray you. You're not allowed to do so. By life, by haya, by the Prophet, we're not allowed to swear by the Prophet. We're not allowed to swear by the Kaaba. We're not allowed to swear by the Kaaba. We're not allowed to swear by mother, father, son, daughter. Now let me ask you, do you think that we are allowed to swear by the Quran? No? What is that? Okay. So this is not the way that the Prophet ﷺ or the Sahaba used to take an oath. But the Quran is essentially an attribute of Allah. It is the speech of Allah. It is Kalamullah. So it's not the proper etiquette. This is not the way the Prophet ﷺ taught us that if you make an oath, the Prophet said, if you take an oath, swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But because we have, for example, cases where someone swears by one of the attributes of Allah, the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Quran in its original form is a sifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's an attribute of Allah. But again, we would not call this kufr or shirk, but we would say that this is not the right way. If you swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So for example, you cannot swear by the Prophet, but you can say Rabbu Muhammad. You cannot say swear by Kaaba, but you can say Rabbul Kaaba. Okay, so let's keep that in mind. And Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, I would rather take a false oath by Allah than a true oath by other than Allah. Okay, so what does this mean? Who can tell us? He says, I would rather take a false oath, if I had only these two choices, take a false oath by Allah or take a true oath by other than Allah. Which one do you do? Yes. So one is a lie and the other is shirk. Between a lie and a shirk, which one is a greater sin? Shirk is a far greater sin. Okay, so he's saying that of course it's a big sin to swear a false oath by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it is not bigger or even equal to committing shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we need to be very careful, and we need to teach our children, we need to teach our women that we don't swear by, no matter how emotional the situation is, don't say, I swear by my mother or by my mother's grave or my son or my son's life or anything like that. None of this. This is a severe sin, and a person has to make sincere tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make istighfar, maybe even give sadaqah, and make a promise not to ever do that again. Now, oaths are not to be taken as jokes. If a person did swear by Allah that I will do such and such, now this person needs to fulfill that. If it is done with intention, if a person just, some people, they have a habit of saying wallahi, wallahi, wallahi on everything. That should not be done in the first place. But if a person did it and he said, no, I didn't really intend to swear by Allah, I was just speaking like I normally speak, because that's how in our culture we speak. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا يُؤَخِذُكُمُ اللَّهُ بِاللَّغْوِ فِي أَيْمَانِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يُؤَخِذُكُمْ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ. So if an oath or a swear is done with intention, without it being forced, so no one forced you that you must take an oath, okay? You took it because of your own freedom and free will to do so. And this person then broke that oath or went against it knowingly and intentionally. Knowingly meaning maybe forgetfully. A person, for example, says, I swear by Allah, I will not drink water for the next 24 hours. And he thought that he was drinking Sprite and it turned out to be water. In this case, did he break his oath? He did not, because he didn't do it knowingly, okay? And sometimes it could be done forgetfully. Maybe he forgot that he has taken this oath, like in Ramadan, when we are fasting, sometimes we might mistakenly eat. That does not break our fast. So if all of these conditions are met, and if a person, now the Prophet ﷺ said that if a person said, Insha'Allah, then there's no penalty for breaking that oath. Okay, if a person says, so it's a good idea, you say, I swear by Allah, if Allah wills, I will bring this to you tomorrow. Now, if you truly intended that, look, my plan is to do it, but if Allah wills and He changes my plan, it's up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if a person said, Insha'Allah, he does not have to pay any expiation, because essentially what this means is that Allah did not will for you to bring it. Okay? So it's a good idea to say inshallah properly. Not just say inshallah, inshallah, inshallah without any meaning. But actually, whenever you make a plan, whenever you give your word to someone, say, look, this is my plan, but inshallah. If Allah wills, then this will happen. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changes our plans, our, you know, the circumstances of our life, then no expiation is needed if a person had said, inshallah. Now, also the Prophet said, if you made an oath, if you swore that you're going to do something, but then you find a better option to do so, then you should do that which is better and give the expiation. Give the expiation. So, if you, for example, one example is, for example, if someone says, I will make i'tikaf in ICBC. I swear by Allah, I will make i'tikaf in ICBC. Then Ramadan comes around and this person gets a chance to make i'tikaf in Masjid al-Haram. Now, Masjid al-Haram is not ICBC. But it is way more rewardable to make it in Masjid al-Haram. Okay? So in this case, a person should not say, well, I took an oath, so I must do it at ICBC. But rather, go for that which is better. In this particular example, I have to check. In fact, maybe there might not even be an expiation. Because you're basically, there might be some intricacies in there. But let's say that any type of thing that a person gave an oath and then a better option comes, then in that case, a person should go for that better option and give an expiation. Now, what is the expiation? What is the penalty or the kafaratul yameen? The first option and the only option for a person who is able to do any of these three is to feed 10 poor people or clothe 10 people, poor people, or free one slave. This is the option. These three, you can choose any one of them equally. Doesn't matter which one is easier on you, you can do that. Now think about how easy is it to feed 10 poor people? How much does it cost? What would you say? $100 back in 2020, you know, 2020 during the COVID time, you could feed 10 people for $100. Now it's 2024, inflation is so high. You know, if you go to buy one meal for yourself, you end up spending easily like $15 to $20, okay? So you are supposed to make that estimation by the average of what you eat. Now, $15 to $20 would be an average meal of one person in our time if we went out to eat. Now, could you manage to get a cheap meal for like $7? Yes, but that's not our average meal. Could you go to an expensive restaurant and get like $75, like a plate of food or something? You could. But the average that most people will consider to be a decent average quality and quantity meal would be about $15 to $20. So you would use that and you would calculate that by 10. And now you need to feed a decent meal to 10 people, or you feed one person 10 times, 10 meals. Okay? Now, clothing-wise, might be even easier. I remember that when I was in madrasa, there used to be some really poor kids that came from, you know, places where their parents couldn't afford anything. They would say, they would send the kid to madrasa because they couldn't feed him at home. So at the time of Ramadan and Eid, someone would come, like some person who wanted to give sadaqah, and he would buy like a big piece of cloth, like multiple tons, and he would give it to a tailor next to the masjid. And he would tell the teacher that, look, all the poor kids, tell them to go to the tailor. He will take their measurements and he will sew them a nice fitted piece of like a full clothing set for the Ramadan or for Eid or whatever the case is. So basically, he would end up giving a set of clothes to maybe 20, 25, 30 kids like that. So it basically costs next to nothing, especially for us living here. But it would be, again, it would not be the lowest of the low. It would not be the highest of the high, but it would be an average of what you wear, an average of what you wear. Or free one slave. Now, freeing one slave, we don't really have this option of freeing a slave just directly. But the scholars say that for a person to spend on someone's legal defense, someone is in jail for some sort of, you know, a lot of times just because somebody is in jail doesn't necessarily mean that they're guilty. Okay, and we have seen a lot of cases that have been overturned because of corrupt prosecutors, corrupt practices of prosecution. So just because, so now if you hear about a good, righteous Muslim brother who's in jail and maybe the system is stacked against him, he doesn't have any money to get a decent lawyer to be able to get a good hearing, for a person to spend on that would be the modern day equivalent of freeing a slave, okay? Now, if a person is not able to do any of this, so this is a person who himself is needy, not able to feed anybody else, not able to clothe anybody else, not able to free anybody else. Now, this person needs to fast 3 days. And the scholars, they said that these 3 days need to be consecutive 3 days. So one, two, three, one after another. Now, lastly, nadr. Nadr is a similar to a vow, which is, a person says, if Allah gives me a son, then I will give $100,000 in charity. Now, the Prophet ﷺ said, or someone says, Na'udhu billah, may Allah protect all of us. Someone's relative gets into like a serious illness, and a person says, if this person is cured from this, I will do X, Y, and Z. I will fast for 1 month nonstop. Okay? Now, the Prophet ﷺ said that making a nadr does not prevent anything. Meaning, if that kid is gonna live, he's going to live. If he was going to die, he's going to die. Your making an oath of nadr is not going to change anything. But he says making a vow or making a nadr does not prevent anything, but it makes a miser spend his property. So somebody who never gives charity, he says, Ya Allah, if you give me this, I will give this. So essentially, what is the Prophet ﷺ telling us in this? Should you make another or should you not make another? What do you think? You should not make another. It doesn't have any benefit. It doesn't prevent any harm, except that you might add an obligation on you, which Allah did not place on you. But if you put it on you, and what the condition you put in there was fulfilled, now it becomes an obligation upon you, and it is now a right of Allah that you must fulfill it. So don't put on yourself what Allah has not put on you, okay? But if you did, and Allah gave you that son or that cure or whatever it is that you wanted, that job, now you must fulfill it. Now you must fulfill it. So if it's permissible, then it must be fulfilled. If it's impermissible, then it must not be fulfilled. So if, na'udhu billah, a person said that if this happens, then I will give, you know, this much money to this singer. Now this is haram. So in this case, a person is obligated to break his vow and give an expiation. And what is the expiation of breaking another? The same as the last one, which is for breaking a yameen, okay? and that's all. But again, these are things that people do where usually they don't understand that, look, it will not bring any benefit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, na'udhu billah, does not benefit from you doing extra worship. Okay? So you can't like bribe Allah saying, ya Allah, if you do this for me, I will do this for you. Allah doesn't need that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever He made an obligation upon us, there is good in it, and He knows that this is something we can do. Whatever He forbade us from, He knows there is good in it, and He knows that we can handle that. To add anything more is essentially extra burden for no good reason. So avoid making another, and also tell our family, tell our kids that, look, don't do this type of stuff. And also the first part, which is making, like, swearing a lot. Saying, wallahi, I swear by Allah, Allah ki qasam, and these type of things that people say, we should avoid saying that. Only if there is a major issue, then a person is asked, okay, if you are telling the truth and swear by Allah, then a person should swear. Other than that, this should not be something, it should be a regular speech, the regular part of our speech, because then it loses value. The more a person swears, the less his swear has any value. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant.